Dame i gospodo, u ime sveučilišta Jurija Dobrile i Fakulteta ekonomije i turizma dr. Mijo Mirković, želim vas sve najtoplije pozdraviti, a osobito upravu sveučilišta i fakulteta, naše drage studente, te vam zaželjeti dobrodošlicu na događaj godine. Iznimna nam je čast ugostiti jednog od najutjecajnijih ekonomista današnjice, profesora sa sveučilišta Cambridge, autora brojnih znanstvenih članaka i svjetski poznatih knjiga, profesora Ha Jun Changa. Profesor Chang održati će predavanje na temu Economics, but not as you know it, no prije nego li krenemo sa predavanjem, zamolila bih rektora, profesora dr. Alfea Barbierija, da se obrati skupu i pozdravi sve prisutne.
Evo, poštovani profesore Chang, poštovane kolegice i kolege, poštovani dragi studenti, svima vam želim dobrodošlicu i srdačne pozdrave. Velika zahvala našem profesoru Chang, koji se odazvao pozivu naših profesora, evo tu profesor Dejan Sinković i profesor Marinko Škare, mi da su zaslužni jeli, za njegov dolazak. Profesor Chang dolazi evo, iz poznatog sveučilišta Cambridgea. To je sveučilište koje se nalazi upravo u tom gradiću, možemo reći, o 100,000 stanovnika, ili pa to nama daje nekakve evo, šanse da mi kao malo središte Pula tijekom godinama koje stoje pred nama, da se može razviti u renomirane sveučilište. Imamo slučaj isto tako nama blizu gradova, isto tako koji nisu veliki, ali koji su renomirani upravo u svjetskim okvirima. Pa tako da evo, to je postoji i da nada. Uvijek je dobro uspostaviti ovakvu suradnju sa poznatim sveučilištima i sa poznatim profesorima. Zašto? Jer možemo imati velike koristi i razviti ne samo našu suradnju, nego i poznavanje tematike ekonomije, ali isto tako uspostaviti suradnju u vezi drugih područja znanosti, bez obzira koje je, da li su to biomedicinske ili neke druge. Tako da, evo, to je početak jedne naše suradnje sa ovim sveučilištem Cambridgeom. Nadamo se da ova suradnja ćemo još i razvijati i da ovo je prvi dolazak našeg profesora. Vjerojatno će uslijediti i puno drugih dolazaka. Evo, pa još jednom hvala svima vama što ste se odazvali tome. Hvala profesori i hvala našim organizatorima i Fakultetu ekonomije i turizma koji su, evo, omogućili dolazak našeg gosta. Hvala lijepa.
Hvala vam, profesore. Molila bih profesora Milforda Batemana, inače konzultanta i gostujućeg predavača na Fakultetu ekonomije i turizma u Puli, te koautora zajedničkih radova sa profesorom Changom, da se obrati skupu te kaže nekoliko riječi o opusu radova i području djelovanja profesora Changa.
I will speak in English, just to give a little description of why Professor Chang is a world authority in the areas that he's been working on in terms of industrial policy and the transformation of economies, issues which really are extremely important to Croatia at its particular time. So it's really a timely visit to stimulate thinking on sorts of areas that Croatia, the sort of problems that Croatia is going through. I was just asked to give a brief resume, if you like. Professor Chang is based at Cambridge University. He's been there a long time. He's based at the Center for Development Studies. His initial work as a South Korean national was on South Korea's amazing transformation from one of the world's poorest economies into one of the world's sort of richest, or at least in the top 20 of developed economies in a very short space of time. And his initial work was on distilling the policy lessons as to why that took place. So his first book was on the political economy of industrial policy. His breakthrough book, though, by all accounts, was a book from 2003 called Kicking Away the Ladder. And this book was the economic history of why some particular countries were able to fashion economic success. And he overturned many of the myths and legends that were attached to these particular countries, that these were free market miracles and that all other countries had to do was to adopt the same policies, when in actual fact these countries all adopted very interventionist policies with solid industrial policies, tariff barriers, etc., etc., which I'm sure he'll explain. And that book really cemented his reputation. He was awarded the Gunnar Myrdal Prize, which is a very prestigious award for that. He later was awarded the Vasily Leontiev Prize for his writings. And then another book came along in 2007, Bad Samaritans, which again distilled the policy advice that the international development communities were giving to developing countries. And it was a case of pretending to be the Good Samaritan, offering good advice, but in actual fact, offering the wrong type of advice. Advice that we had rejected in the developed economies, we gave the opposite of what made our economies richer. A book then in 2010 was 23 Things They Don't Tell You About Capitalism, which attacked individual myths, if you like, about the orthodox economics. And that was out in 2010. And in 2014, I think Professor Chang's going to talk about this, Economics, the User's Guide. So this is looking at why there are various schools of thought, and you need to have a very, you need to understand all of these because they are useful in different situations, and there is no very dogmatic line, I must be this type of economist or that type. It's a lot more intelligent to take some understanding from all of them. His books have been translated into 40 languages and have sold 2 million worldwide, which for economics books is not quite J.K. Rowling, but not far short, really, in terms of economics books, unprecedented. And Professor Chang just told me that the latest edition, or one of the latest editions, is out in Croatian. So you'll be able to buy that. So that's really what I can add for that. Okay, that's fine.
Hvala profesoru Bejtmanu. Sada, nakon dugog iščekivanja, molim vas da pljeskom pozdravite profesora Ha Jun Changa.
Yeah. Right. Thank you, Rector. Thank you, Milford. It's my great pleasure to be in Croatia, in Pula, in this university, in this faculty. Yeah, I've always wanted to come here. You know, Milford has been telling me to come for many years, and Sonia was trying to organize a big conference here. I was actually supposed to come, and then I had health problem. I couldn't travel, so I had to come virtually through video link. I'm finally here. I'm really delighted. Yes, today I want to talk about my latest book, Economics, the User's Guide. I mean, the cover that you see there is the American edition. This is the British edition that came out earlier. Actually, I'm quite proud of this. I mean, I don't try to boast about things that if I can avoid it, but you know, this one, you know, this Pelikan paperback series is a very old series. Started in 1929 with a famous book by George Bernard William Shaw, An Intelligent Woman's Guide to Capitalism, Socialism, Communism, and Fascism. And it lasted for like 60 years, you know, producing volumes on every subject, from ants to Oriental philosophy, from economics to design, over 3,000 titles. And this went into, however, hibernation because, you know, the market was changing. They didn't adapt quickly enough. In 2011, they decided to revive the series, and I mean, very, I don't know whether you can see it. I mean, my book is the first one in the new series. So I'm very proud about this and would like to donate a copy to this faculty so you can have it in the library. I mean, I even signed it there. So let's keep it there. Well, why did I write this book, which is supposed to be a very kind of user-friendly guide, introductory guide to economics? You know, actually, that when you talk to people who are not economists, they think it's yes, important because a lot of what happens around me is about economics. It's about my job, my wages, my pension, inflation. But they say, well, it's too complicated for us. Yeah? You know, it's technical. I don't understand the jargons. You know, mathematics, graphs. You know. I get confused, yeah? That's the normal reaction. And therefore they say, I'm very happy to leave it to the specialist. Yeah? However, the same people have very strong opinion about everything else, yeah? Yeah, the European Union, you know, gay marriage, American foreign policy, nuclear energy, climate change, you name it, yeah? Without having any qualification to make judgment on those things. You know, I have very strong views on American foreign policy, but what do I know about international politics? Yeah? Back in 1983, as an undergraduate student, I took a course called Introduction to International Relations. Yeah? And my professor, this crusty old man, was using an American textbook from the 1960s. Yeah? So what little I know about international politics is at least 50 years outdated. Yeah? But then I have no problem in saying, oh, the US should not get involved in this and that. You know, I'm sure other people are the same. You know, I mean, if you really want to, you know, say something about, say, gay marriage, yeah, I mean, you have to have some foundation in the ethics, yeah, religion, yeah, biology, psychology. Very few people have the knowledge of all of these things, but they are not afraid of having a strong opinion on these things. In contrast, as I said earlier, when it comes to economics, most people think, oh, it's not for me, it's too difficult. But why? Why should economics be different? Well, my interpretation is that it is only because my professional colleagues have been fantastically successful in making people believe that the subject is so difficult that ordinary people cannot understand it, even if we bother to explain it to them. But actually, I have openly said in my earlier book, 23 Things They Don't Tell You About Capitalism, which is now in creation. In that book, I said 95% of economics is common sense. Yeah? Well, of course, it's made to look difficult, yeah, with the use of mathematics, graphs, jargons. But in the end, I mean, they are common sense. Yeah. Yeah, and of course, I mean, there are the remaining 5% that are quite technical, you know, that it's not common sense, but even those things can be understood by ordinary people if someone bothers to explain them in a user-friendly way. So I am actually trying in this book to do that. And in order to do that, I pull all the stops that I can think of. So the book has all of these things in it. Yeah? Yeah, believe it or not, that you even have a Scarlett Johansson. Not a picture, you know, it's only a cheap paperback, you know, that there's no room for photos, but, you know, she's there, and, you know, the Big Bang Theory, Mary Poppins. You might be asking, what is that children's story doing? But, you know, believe me, as you will find out in the introduction to Chapter 8 on finance, Mary Poppins has the best description of what a bank run is. Some of you might remember that scene where this little boy goes to bank where his father works, and they try to take his money away, and he screams, give me back my money, and all the other customers hears him, and they go into panic. There must be something wrong with this bank. Give me my money, give me my money, and there's a bank run. Anyway. You know, I use all of these to make this friendly to people who don't know anything about economics. But this is not a book that tries to give my reader some kind of baby version of economics, or idiot's guide to economics. I take my readers really seriously, so I talk about all kinds of fundamental issues, like whether economics can be a science, what are the ethical foundations of economics, whether we can separate economics from politics, how there are many different ways of conceptualizing the economy, and why they matter, and so on. So even for, you know, people like you, professional economists, there'd be a lot of things to enjoy in this book. It's an introduction, but it's not an idiot's guide, if you like. No, because there are all these books. I mean, and I'm not saying that they are, you know, useless. I mean, they can be quite useful. But books that will say, well, this is what economists say, memorize these five things, you know, seven truths about the free market, and six things you need to know about the international trade, fine, you know. But there are deeper stuff, and I'm trying to give you even those things in this book. So as you can see from this table of contents, the book contains lots of things that you don't normally see in an introductory economics book. So the definition of economics in chapter one, I'll talk about that a bit more. I mean, the chapters two and three give you economic history. Chapter four tells you about different schools of economics and what their strengths and weaknesses are. And then I talk about some topics that are usually ignored in the economics these days. You know, the production is not clearly discussed in economics. Work is another interesting subject matter. You know, economists discuss work only when it's not there. Unemployment. So they talk about unemployment a lot, but they don't talk about how people work. I'll talk about that a bit later. So there are these topics. And then another thing is that my book introduces my readers to what I call real life numbers. Now, the popular impression is that economics is a numbers subject. And indeed, you open, you know, economics journals, there are lots of numbers, equations, you know. Despite that, it's actually quite common these days that people graduate with an economics degree without having any idea of some fairly basic numbers about the real world. Yeah? How many of you know what is the GDP of Croatia? Maybe you know that, but do you know what is the GDP of the world? I mean, what proportion of it is produced by the United States or China? Actually, very few people know these things. Yeah? Well, for your information, well, I looked it up. Croatia's GDP is about 0.06 trillion US dollars against 3.6 trillion of Germany and 2.1 trillion of Italy. World GDP is about 78 trillion. That was 2014, so it might be close to 80 now. And 22.5% of that is produced by the US, 13% of that is produced by China, and so on. Yeah? Now, of course, in this internet age, you don't need to know any of this. Yeah? You need to know only one thing, Google. Yeah, you can look them up anytime, yeah? Anywhere. Yeah? But my view is that actually, you need to have some feel of these numbers, even just to know what to look up. Huh? Because when you have no idea, because I ask my students that, what do you think is GDP of China? Is it tens of trillions or a few trillions or hundreds of billions? They have no idea. They don't even know the order of magnitude, and you really need to know some of these things to understand how the world looks like. And if you get some of these basic numbers wrong, you can form a very distorted picture of real-world economies. So let's take the case of Greek crisis. When the crisis in Greece happened, there was this popular rhetoric coming mainly out of Germany, the Netherlands, and maybe Finland, saying, well, Greece is in trouble because their people are lazy. Yeah? They borrow like Germans, work like Greeks, what do you expect? They're in trouble, yeah? Because they have 3-hour lunch and party every night. Yeah? They need to work harder. Yeah? They need to tighten their belt, work longer, work harder. But when you actually look up these statistics, Greeks are actually the hardest working people in Europe. Yeah? And of course, half of them are unemployed now, but as far as they work the longest hours in Europe. Yeah? The Germans work 30% less than the Greeks. The Dutch work 40% less than the Greeks. Yeah, actually, the Dutch are officially the laziest people in the world. Yeah? They work the shortest hours in the world. Yeah? And then you think that Greece's problem is people not working hard. Yeah? Now, I'm not saying that Greece doesn't have problems, yeah? But its problems is productivity. Yeah? If the problem is productivity, you should have discussed what Greece should do in terms of investment, infrastructure, R&D, education, skills. None of this was discussed. Yeah? It was all down to morality. Yeah? Greeks need to shape up. Yeah? They need to work harder, work longer. Yeah? So we are discussing things that are completely irrelevant. Yeah? We should have discussed how you raise the productivity of the Greeks, not how you make them work longer, harder. Yeah, another interesting myth that I can bust in this regard is, did you know that Mexico now has the longest working hour in the OECD? Yeah? It's the hardest working people in the OECD. Yeah? Even longer than Koreans. Eh? Mexicans work 25 longer than the Americans. Eh? And then you go to America, the Mexicans are the sort of stereotypical lazy Latino. Yeah? Oh, they don't work hard. I mean, that's why they are poor. Yeah? We'll build the wall and keep them out. Yeah? So this is just one example, but you know, you need to have some feel of this number. So throughout this book, I'm trying to give my readers some sense of how the world looks like. Yeah? I mean, what kind of income per capita are we talking about when we say, I don't know, the Ethiopia or Burundi is are very poor, you know? I mean, what do you mean when you say South Africa has a very high unemployment, yeah? Which happens to be around 30%, yeah? There's a lot of emphasis on the so-called real-life numbers, but even while emphasizing the importance of numbers, I emphasize how numbers always need to be taken with a pinch of salt, as they say in English, yeah? Or sometimes a bag of salt, yeah? Because these numbers are very suspicious. You know, as Johann Wolfgang von Goethe once said, everything factual is already a theory, because all numbers are categorized and measured according to a particular theory. So even numbers are not that free of value judgment. Yeah, so take the most common number in the economics, GDP. You know, GDP does not include the household work and care work that is done within families and communities. Yeah? Of course, most of this is done by women, and this failure to include this aspect of the economy leads to a gross undervaluation of women's contribution to the economy. Because to those people who collect GDP, you know, mothers and sisters who stay at home to take care of the family have zero economic value. But when they decide to hire someone to cook, they are creating economic value. So, you know, one of the sort of old economist jokes, which is not very funny, that typically for an economist joke, is that when you marry your housekeeper, you are reducing your country's GDP. Yeah? Because you used to pay her, now you don't. Yeah? Why are we not including this in the GDP? Yeah? The typical response is, oh, it's too difficult to estimate. No, it's not. Yeah? No, there is a going rate for a cook or cleaner or a nurse. You can calculate it. And those who collect GDP statistics go out of their way to include other things. Yeah? So for example, they impute value on the dwelling service that you are getting from your own house. Yeah? Because if you are renting an apartment, you are paying the landlord. Yeah? That gets counted as a part of GDP. Yeah? If you live in your own house, you don't pay anything. But these national accountants actually estimate what you would have paid to your landlord, i.e. yourself, if you rented it from yourself. Yeah? When you include those kind of things, why is it that impossible to include the household work by women in GDP? Yeah? It's a theoretical political decision. It's not because of the pragmatic difficulties. Huh? Yeah, you can go on and on about these things. You know, when you're measuring unemployment, you know, the usual definition is that someone should be willing to work, which is measured by whether this person has applied for a paid employment in the last 4 weeks. But why is it four? Why is it not six? Why is it not two? Why is it not 12? Yeah. And the definition of working is a paid work that is more than 1 hour per week. You know, a lot of people will say, well, that working 1 hour per week is not working. Yeah? But this is the definition. Yeah? I'm not saying that this is necessarily worse than some other definition, but you have to be clearly aware that there is a very particular definition based on a certain view of the world, maybe not some lofty ideological principle like the refusal to include the women's work in GDP, but this is still based on a certain view of the world. Yeah? I could carry on, but the point that I'm trying to make is that numbers in economics are like sausages. Huh? You don't know what's got in them, and you don't want to know what is in them. Yeah? You just eat, yeah, because it's tasty. Yeah? Okay, let's talk about some of my topics in some depth. First of all, the definition of economics. Well, if you ask people who have no knowledge of economics, what do you think is economics? The usual answer you get is, must be the study of the economy, you know, chemistry's study of chemicals, yeah? Biology's study of living things. Yeah? So economics must be the study of the economy. Yeah? However, if you ask economists, this is not the answer. Yeah? For them, economics is the science of everything. Yeah? Well, you might think, well, that's not true, but you know, look at these books. Three of the most popular economics books of our time, you know, Tim Harford, the financial journalist, his first book was called The Undercover Economist. The second book is called The Logic of Life. And he says it's uncovering the new economics of everything. Yeah? Freakonomics, arguably the most popular economics book of our time, is supposed to be exploring the hidden side of everything. Yeah? And the third one is by Robert Frank, the professor from Cornell University, who writes for the New York Times, his famous Economic Naturalist series. And, well, actually, he's a very modest man. He doesn't say everything. He says that the economics can explain almost everything. Yeah? Now, when you look at this, you might wonder, actually, this is quite a big claim coming from a subject that has spectacularly messed up what was supposed to be its main job, namely understanding and managing the economy. Yeah? You know, this subject put the world in the biggest turmoil in the two generations, and very few economists that can claim to have predicted that this kind of crisis. So it wasn't doing its, I mean, even its own job properly, and then now these people come out and say we can explain everything. Yeah? So you could say this is a serious case of megalomania. Yeah? Well, it is a kind of megalomania, but it's a very particular kind of megalomania. Because, you know, I mean, these people could have said how economists can explain everything about the economy. Yeah? No, but they didn't say that. They said we can explain everything. Yeah? And the reason why they can make the claim is because they did adopt this very particular definition of economics, which the classic statement of which comes from Lionel Robbins. He was a professor at LSE in the early part of the 20th century. He wrote this famous essay called An Essay on the Nature and Significance of Economic Science, in which he basically defined economics as a theory of rational choice. Yeah? This definition doesn't say that economics is about the economy. Yeah? It's just about means and ends. Yeah. Now, most economists have used this definition in the last couple of generations. But when you think about it, this is a very unique definition of a subject, because all other subjects are defined by the object of inquiry or the field of inquiry. Yeah? So as I said earlier, chemistry is about chemicals, biology is about living things. But this definition defines the subject in terms of its analytical methodology. Yeah? This is quite strange. Yeah? Because, for example, if you go to a biology department, you have people studying living organisms with all kinds of methods. Yeah? So yes, I mean, there'll be people, you know, doing DNA analysis. Some others will be doing anatomy. Still others might be studying animal bone structure as if it's they are structure engineers. Yeah? There'll be people doing mathematical modeling of animal behavior. You know, there'll be people doing nasty experiments with rats. Yeah? And there are even people who fly to the jungles of Burundi and Rwanda, sit with mountain gorillas all day, and write down what they do. Yeah? And they are all called biologists, because the biologists are smart enough to know that living organisms are complex. Yeah? You cannot guess the phenotype from DNA. You cannot guess behavior from the phenotype. Yeah? You cannot guess the behavior of the whole pack from behavior of individuals and so on. And they recognize that we need to study living organisms at many different levels using very different methodologies. Yeah? But in economics, there's supposed to be only one right way of doing economics. Eh? Mathematical modeling of optimization based on neoclassical theory. Yeah, and later you use maybe econometrics or randomized controlled trials to verify the model, but that's it. Yeah? So if you are, I don't know, some empirical economist going around factories interviewing the managers and workers, trying to understand how production is organized, yeah, which is the economics equivalent of you know, going to the jungles and watching the gorillas, yeah, people would think that there's something wrong with you. Yeah? No, what are you doing? I mean, they're all these data sets, yeah, you can download them, run regressions, yeah. You're actually talking to real people, yeah? You are not an economist, yeah? So our subject has developed this perverse intellectual hierarchy, yeah? In which the less related to the real world and the more abstract it is what you do, the cleverer you are. Yeah? So if you're the cleverest, you'll be doing mathematical modeling of something that has very little to do with reality, like, I don't know, Turing machines or self-learning automata, yeah? Things like that. Yeah? If you're a bit less clever, yes, maybe you will do game theoretic modeling of the oligopolistic behavior. Yeah? If you're not that clever, then you become an econometrician. Yeah? But if you are smart of the econometricians, you will do econometric theory, not running regressions on real-world data. Yeah? And if you are not even that good, you study development economics like I do, yeah? Or labor economics. Yeah? If you are not even that good, you become an economic historian. Yeah? And if you are, you know, actually visiting actual factories or, yeah, shops and interviewing the real people, then you are not even an economist. Yeah? No, I exaggerate, but you know, I mean, there's a serious problem, yeah, in our subject, in which we are defining the subject in terms of analytical methodology rather than the object of investigation. Yeah? So my contention is that, you know, like all other subjects, economics should be defined in terms of its subject matter, that is the economy, or how you produce the goods and services, how you distribute the incomes generated in the process, and how we exchange and consume those goods and services that have been produced. And yeah, I think we should stop defining the subject in terms of the analytical methodology or the theoretical approach. You know, because when you pick up books like the Free Economics, yeah, there's actually very little that is about the economy. Yeah? It's about the Japanese sumo wrestlers cheating, American school teachers cheating, yeah? I mean, how people behave on quiz shows, you know? Why Chicago drug dealers have to live with their mother because they are not earning enough money. You know, these are all kind of interesting and even cute stories, but they are not about the economy. Yeah? It's not about, yeah, how we produce things. It's not about income inequality. It's not about, yeah, inflation. It's not about, yeah, all the things that ordinary people think are the subjects of economics. Yeah? Now, this definition of economics comes from the dominant school of economics, the neoclassical school. And one consequence of this definition is that most neoclassical economists believe that there's only one right way of doing economics. But in this book, I spent a whole long chapter to discuss how there are at least nine schools of economics and easily two dozen if you include smaller schools or divide up some of these larger schools into separate sub-schools, yeah? And how they have very different ways of theorizing about the world, how they have very different interests, and how they all have crucial strengths and weaknesses. Yeah? So let's, I cannot go into all of this, but let's take these three schools that I have highlighted in bold. These are all schools that can, you know, endorse the free market policies. I say can because neoclassical economics, you know, a lot of people misunderstand and say neoclassical economics is free market economics. No, it's not. Yeah, it's got an important kind of subgroup which are very interested in the phenomenon of market failure. And these people will be very happy to endorse a lot of state intervention. Yeah? The modern examples would include people like Paul Krugman and Joseph Stiglitz, but in the old days, you had the famous Polish economist Oskar Lange, who was basically advocating decentralized planning system under socialism by using neoclassical general equilibrium model. So it's not, correct to think that neoclassical economics is free market economics, although today the majority of neoclassical economists would be the free market economists. But in these three schools, they all justify their support of free market in completely different ways. So, for example, in neoclassical economics, individual is the ultimate sovereign. Yeah? So individuals have preferences, they choose, and the market mechanism, you know, collate those things and reconcile their differences and produce a certain outcome, which if you don't take market failure seriously is the best that served if you take a free market approach. In classical economics, however, there are really no individuals. Yeah, there are individuals at the rhetorical level. Because these economists wrote that at the time when they were asserting the power of, if you like, industrial capitalists against the landlord class and feudalism. So at the rhetorical level, there are a lot of the individuals, but at the theoretical level, at the core of it, it's class economics, like Marxist economics. Basically, the theory is that you have capitalists, landlords, and workers, and how your surplus is divided up between these three classes determines the rate of accumulation and economic growth. It's a class-based theory like Marxism. It's not an individualistic theory like neoclassical economics. Austrian economics represented by von Mises and von Hayek. Yes, the Austrian economics is the individualistic theory, but A, the individuals are conceptualized in a very different way. Because in neoclassical economics, individuals know what they want. The world is very certain. At most, you will have a probabilistic risk, but nothing like uncertainty. Austrians very much emphasize that the world is very uncertain, our knowledge is limited, our rationality is limited. So in that sense, they are actually quite similar to institutionalist, especially the old institutionalist school and behavioralist school. And they argue that that's the fundamental fact of life. And when they justify free market, the neoclassical justification of free market is basically people know what they are doing, so leave them alone. The Austrian justification is, of course, I'm simplifying. The Austrian justification is no one really knows what's going on, so how dare you, the government, thinks that you know better. These are two completely different ways of justifying free market solution. I mean, personally, I find the Austrian justification more persuasive, but that's not the point here. The point is that these three schools justify the same result, if you like, using completely different methodologies, completely different ways of conceptualizing the economy. So that all these different schools, they conceptualize the economy differently. So classical Marxist, at least the post-Keynesian wing of the Keynesian school are class-based theories. Austrians and neoclassicals are more individualistic. Keynesians, institutionalists, behavioralists, these people that emphasize uncertainty and limited human knowledge. Neoclassicals and Marxists and classicals are very confident about the world. The classical economists, the Marxists, they used to talk about the iron law, It's like scientific law, that it's like law of gravity. Profit rates will fall, that the wages will always remain at the subsistence level. They were so certain about the world, as are neoclassical economists in their own ways. The Keynesians, behavioralists, the Austrians, institutionalists, they say, no, the world is very complex. Human knowledge is limited. Of course, we set up rules and then constrain the individual behavior in order to increase certainty, but we can never solve this problem. I mean, I can go on with these kind of examples, but you see the point. How the society is composed. Is it individuals or classes? What individuals are like? I mean, how rational they are, how complex the world is. Yeah? I mean, they're all very different. Yeah? And my contention is that we need all these diverse approaches to economics in order to understand the world, because the world is complex. Yeah? And, you know, instead of giving you any further theoretical arguments, I give you what I call the Singapore problem, or life is stranger than fiction, to prove this point. Now, when you read about Singapore in standard economics textbooks, or in, I don't know, the Wall Street Journal, the Economist magazine, you will only hear about its free trade policies and its welcoming attitude towards foreign investors. Yeah, which it of course has, yeah? But you will never be told that 90% of land in Singapore is owned by the government, 85% of housing is provided by a government-owned housing board, and a staggering 22% of GDP is produced by state-owned enterprises, including the famous Singapore Airlines. So I often put it to my students, well, give me one economic theory. It doesn't matter what it is, Marxist, institutionalist, neoclassical, Austrian, that can single-handedly explain the Singaporean case. I dare say there's no such theory. Real world is complex, and all theories can necessarily theorize in a limited way, and I say we need to know all of these different schools to an extent in order to really understand the world. When people ask me, who are the three most influential economists on your thinking? Yeah? And my answer is usually Marx, Hayek, and Herbert Simon, the father of the behavioralist school. Yeah? These are all completely different people. Yeah? Probably they'll kill each other if you put them in the same room. But you know, if you haven't read these three people, you should all read them. Yeah? Because they see the world in a very different way. They have very different political values, but they're all very profound thinkers. And only when you read all of these people together, you will understand how complex the world is. Yeah? So in the book, I argue that we should let 100 flowers bloom. You know, there isn't just one right way of doing economics, but there are many schools of economics, with each with its own strengths and weaknesses. And no theory can explain everything. Yeah? So let 100 flowers bloom, as Chairman Mao Zedong used to say. Of course, when he said that, he had an ulterior motive. He wanted 100 flowers to bloom, so that he can cut the ones he didn't like. Yeah? Well, I don't have that intention, I don't have that power, so it's a genuine plea for pluralism. But my idea about pluralism is not just live and let live. Yeah? We need active cross-fertilization of ideas. Yeah? I mean, I explained briefly in the book how mixing the insights from some of these different schools will improve our understanding. I cannot go into them, but basically, we need an approach which embraces this diversity of intellectual tradition. Because there are some people who argue for pluralism on political ground. Yeah? You know, was it Voltaire or Montaigne? I mean, one of these famous French thinkers once said to someone, "Sir, I completely disagree with you, but I'm willing to die for your freedom to say what you think." Yeah? That's political pluralism. Yeah? My view is that we need to go beyond that. Yeah? No, actually, what he says I can also learn from him. Yeah? He should also learn from me. Yeah? It's not because I respect freedom of speech that I respect someone else. I mean, it's because everyone has something useful to say. I'm not saying that you should say, well, everyone's correct, everyone's wrong equally, you know. No, you should have your strong opinion of your own, but you have to have an open mind, you have to have, you know, the humbleness to learn from other people and work with other people. So my advice is that, you know, this is a saying that in English, that he who has a hammer sees everything as a nail. Yeah? So if you give someone a hammer, he begins to bang everything. Yeah, it'll be great if he happens to be banging a nail. If it's a screw, okay, I mean, it might just work. I mean, it's not ideal, but, you know, might work. But if you are banging a jelly or a football, it will be completely ineffective. If you are banging an egg, it will be a disaster. Yeah? So my advice is that you should not be a man or a woman with a hammer. You have to get a Swiss army knife. Yeah, yeah, with a range of tools. And of course, you have to know what to use when. Yeah, this is why you have to study not just economic theory, but history, philosophy, ethics, politics, and so on. So get a Swiss army knife. Yeah? Don't be a man or a woman with a hammer. Yeah? Okay. Yeah, I said I was going to talk about the subject of work. Let me talk about it briefly because it's I think useful to illustrate how some of these neglected topics are actually very important. You know, I already said that work is a curious thing because it's discussed by economists only when it's not there, yeah? Only when there is unemployment. Yeah? But when you think about it, I mean, our life is actually dominated by work. Yeah? I mean, if you're a person of working age, you are actually spending at least half of their waking hours in work. Yeah? You know, in roughly speaking, 24 hours, you sleep 8 hours. Yeah? You work 8 hours, you do other things for 8 hours. Yeah? So one third of your entire life or the half of your waking hours, you are spending in work. Yeah? Well, unless you are Dutch and you don't work. Yeah? If you include the commuting time, it's even longer. Yeah? If you live in London, you are typically commuting for 1 hour. If you live in Tokyo, you are typically commuting for 1.5 hours. If you are one of the unfortunate black guys stuck in one of these townships, these are special towns that the apartheid regime built for the blacks in South Africa, if you are one of the unfortunate guys who are stuck in these townships, you could be spending up to 6 hours a day just commuting. Yeah? Because the apartheid regimes built these black towns far away from the main city. Yeah? They didn't give them the proper public transport. Yeah? And the roads are bad. So these people have to rely on these minibuses, which are for some reason called taxis, run by criminal gangsters who charged a ridiculous amount of money. And yeah, you could be spending up to 3 hours one way. Yeah? And another 3 going back home. So if you're working, I don't know, 8 hours, 10 hours, yeah, you're basically spending 80% of your waking hours in work or for work. So work is that important, but we don't talk about work. Yeah? I mean, for most economists, economics ends when people go to work. Yeah? It ends at the factory gate. It ends at the entrance of the office building. Yeah? What happens inside is the job of, the management the studies, psychologists, sociologists, but it's not for economics. Yeah? Why do they do that? Because the dominant school of economics, the neoclassical school, essentially conceptualizes people as consumers. Yeah? So our aim in life is to consume. And we work only because we need money to buy things or services to consume. And you will work only up to the point where the utility that you get from the things that you can buy with your wages is at least equal to the disutility that you get from working. Because you are supposed to, as a good consumer, prefer leisure to work, other things being equal. But is this how the world really works? You know, we are producers as well. Some of you might think that's just a philosophical discussion. It's not. So suppose, you begin to accept, say, cheaper imports from China. As a consumer, it's great. But this means that as a producer, you might be losing your job. This is not a trivial matter. So what happens in our workplace fundamentally affects us, not just our wages, our immediate physical and psychological well-being, but also our identity, self-fulfillment, sense of self-worth. The Marxist school has a very strongly emphasize that humans are producers. Yeah? So what happens to us in our place of work really matters to our well-being, identity, and self-realization. So if you're just looking at consumption, you may be measuring your kind of the well-being in the completely wrong way. So for example, in many of the richer countries of the world, people have in the last, say, couple of decades seen, of course, that we had the financial crisis recently, but probably have seen an increase in income and therefore consumption by 10%, 20%. Yeah? Does it mean that people are happier? No, not necessarily, because in many countries, their work life has become more stressful. Yeah? I mean, jobs have become more insecure, work intensity has increased, your commutes have become longer and more crowded, so people actually do not necessarily feel happier, because what happens in their work or in the process of getting to work is worse than before. I don't know, I'm not a labor economist, I'm not a specialist in the human psychology or whatever, but these are serious issues that we need to look at. But because we conceptualize people as consumers and completely neglected the subject of work, we have developed a very kind of distorted measure of how that we improve the human well-being. Okay, now I'm getting into the final aspects of the book. Now, throughout the book, I emphasize that economics is a political subject. Even when most neoclassical economists claim that what they do is a value-free science. These people, economics used to be called political economy until the late 19th century, but neoclassical school came along and said, no, the economics is a science. There's no room for politics, which is subjective. And in claiming the kind of apolitical nature of economics, neoclassical economists have used allegedly apolitical ethical standard called Pareto criterion. Now, Pareto was this half Italian, half French economist who taught in Switzerland in the late 19th, early 20th century. Before Pareto, most economists were philosophically utilitarians. Yeah, I mean, you heard of this, you know, the greatest benefit of happiness of the greatest majority. Yeah? But Pareto and some of his colleagues came along and said, no, no, that's actually a wrong way of running the society. Yeah? Because it means that we can sacrifice minority for the interest of the majority. Yeah? Yeah, and this was a serious point. Yeah? And then to illustrate this, I have invented this little story, which I call the one finger story. Yeah? The story goes like this, tomorrow morning, someone knocks at my door and tells me, oh, Dr. Chang, we invented this fantastic technology that will solve the problem of climate change overnight. Huh? Actually, we have already built the machine. It's all ready. We need one tiny input in order to start this machine. And we want you to have the honor of providing that input. Huh? So I say, what is it? Huh? And this say, we need one live human finger. Hmm? Can you donate that finger? Yeah? No, I mean, even before they finish the sentence, I'll walk into my kitchen, cut my finger off, and give it to them. You know, I'm saving the world. Yeah? But what if it's one arm? Of course, I'll do it. Yeah? But what if it's my life? Yeah? Life of my whole family? Life of whole 50 million South Koreans? You know, what is 50 million against 7 billion? You know, it's nothing. Yeah? Where do you stop? Yeah? So before you know it, you are in the same bed with Stalin and Hitler. Yeah, I can kill a few million people in order to save socialism, or I can kill 6 million Jews to preserve the purity of the German nation. Yeah? Why not? Yeah? So Pareto was saying, no, this is wrong. Yeah? You cannot do this. Yeah? So he proposed that we should call a social change an improvement only if it makes at least some people better off without making anyone worse off. Yeah, yeah, so it's a very important and noble principle against tyranny of the majority, but it has its own problems. Yeah? So go to the other extreme, and let's talk about this country called Equatorial Guinea. Yeah? It's a small country on the west coast of Africa, only 700,000 people, tiny land mass. It used to be one of the 30 poorest countries in the world until like 1995. Now it's the richest country in Africa. Yeah? It's as rich as actually South Korea. Yeah? Per capita income of $22,000. Huh? How did this miracle happen? Well, they found oil. Hmm? Unfortunately, the American companies come and pump the oil out, and the president who has been in power for, I don't know, I mean, 30 years or something, his family takes most of this wealth. Yeah? So the rest of the country, okay, I mean, there's some crumbs, yeah, but you know, basically live like Africa. This tiny elite live like they are living in California or Milan, you know. So in that country, a lot of people find it totally reasonable to say, well, we have to take away, I don't know, 15% of this president family's wealth and give it to other people. Well, if you seriously believe in Pareto principle, you cannot do that, yeah? Because you are hurting someone. Yeah, yeah, for the same logic, we had this famous land reform in East Asia in the 1950s. You shouldn't have done that, yeah? Because you hurt the landlords. Yeah? I'm not saying that there's an easy answer. Yeah? My personal view is that all ethical principles taken to the extreme becomes a monster. Yeah? Utilitarianism, Pareto, anything. Yeah? But the point is not whether this is better or worse, but the point is that even the supposedly a political Pareto criterion is a very political position, yeah, because it gives priority to the status quo. Yeah? They don't ask questions about where that status quo came from. Yeah? So it is very political. Yeah? Well, actually, the political nature of economics goes even deeper, because deciding what belongs in the domain of the market is itself an intensely political exercise. Eh? The best way to see this is to think about the regulation of child labor. Yeah, of course, the poor children have worked since the beginning of humanity. Yeah? But when the Industrial Revolution happened in Britain, this became a serious problem because now you had machines which could mean that children could do the work of others. Yeah? So a lot of factories that employed children, and of course they had a huge amount of industrial accidents and lack of education, a lot of problems. So some reformist parliamentarians brought this proposal to the British Parliament in 1819, saying we need to regulate child labor. Eh? And by the standard of today, this was a joke. Yeah? Because what is said, first of all, we are going to apply this only to the cotton factories. Yeah? And apparently at the time, the technologies used for the production of cotton textile generated a lot of dust, which would accumulate in the lungs of the workers. I mean, it's bad enough if you're an adult, but if you're a child, your lung cannot even grow because of this dust. Yeah? So a lot of children working in cotton factories die. Yeah? So they said that this is the worst kind of job for children, so we need to restrict this. Yeah? They actually, however, did not mention any other type of factory. They didn't mention coal mines, nothing, yeah? Only cotton factory. And they said, we are not going to ban child labor. Well, for all children, we are going to ban it only for very young children, yeah? Under the age of 8. So up to 8, you cannot work. From 9, you can. And between 9 and 16, yeah? Because from 16, you are not a child anymore. Between 9 and 16, we will restrict the number of hours they can work. To how many hours? Any guess? How many hours per day? Huh? 12, that's right, yeah. This was a time when adults work 16 hours a day on average. Yeah? So 12 was considered very generous. Yeah? So by today's standard, this is a joke. Yeah? But even then, a lot of people were against this because they said this is undermining the fundamental foundation of a free market economy, namely the freedom of contract. You know, these the children want to work. These people want to hire them. What is your problem? Huh? Now, it's not like these factory owners kidnapped these children and made them into slaves. Yeah? These children want to work. They want to hire them. You have to respect that. Yeah? Well, fast forward 200 years, you know, today, I mean, not even Donald Trump says that we need to bring child labor back. Yeah? Well, although, I mean, American politician came close to it, Newt Gingrich, who was in the last presidential election. He once proposed that poor children should work as janitors in their schools. Yeah? So they would remain in the school, clean the school, you know, fix things. Well, of course, under the supervision of an adult janitor, and you know they'll be exempted from certain fees and so on. But you know, I mean, when he said that, you know, even a lot of Republican Party members said that this is ridiculous. Yeah? But when you think about it, I mean, why should children not work? Yeah? You know, there's no economic theory that children shouldn't work. Yeah? But in the last 200 years, at least in the rich countries, there's been a fundamental shift in the underlying political and ethical view that people find it unacceptable that the right, the freedom of contract should have precedent over children's right to have education and childhood. Yeah? Well, once you accept that hierarchy of rights, then this is not even an issue. If you don't accept that, you know, whether children should work becomes an economic issue. So the point that I'm trying to make is that deciding even what is in the economy itself is a political decision. Yeah? You know, 200 years ago, you could buy and sell people in many countries as slaves. Yeah? In America, in Brazil, you could do that. Perfectly legal. Yeah? In most countries, you could use child labor without any restriction. Yeah? Subsequently, these countries have made the decision that, no, you shouldn't buy and sell people, you shouldn't employ people, but that was not because of change in economic theory. Yeah? It was because of change in politics and ethics. Yeah? Okay, I think I have spoken too long, so I'm going to cut out the last bit and try to conclude the presentation. Okay, so today I have tried to argue how economics should be much broader than what it is today and can be actually made more exciting than what is taught in the existing curriculum. You know, it's not, as many people think, a dry subject full of abstract ideas and squiggles and equations. It is a subject that can, and really has to include everything. Every aspect of the human life, as far as is related to the economy. Yeah, so it's got the ethical dimension, political dimension. Yeah? And I hope my talk today has stimulated your interest in learning economics as a much broader subject and stimulated your interest in exploring the subject more widely and deeply. Thank you very much.
Profesor je spreman za pitanja, pa slobodno, imamo jedan mikrofon.
Thank you. I am the only student of this faculty.
Can you not put the microphone too close?
Yeah. I have one question, short question. As a world famous economist, can you foresee or predict what would be the new development industry paradigm, like in the past decade, in the invention of microchip initiated IT growth? So,
Thanks for the question. By definition, if you are really innovating, you are doing something that everyone else thinks is going to fail. Yeah? So there is no way that however much economics you learn, you can predict, well, this will be the next best technology, this will be the next successful company, but I think Econx still gives you some tools to understand how technology evolves and so on. I mean, I'm not going to say the obvious things, but I think the couple of things that, I mean, I have learned from doing research on industrial policy is, first of all, you know, when people hear the word innovation, they only think about the big things, yeah? I mean, Tesla, you know, microchips, yeah? Nuclear fusion. No, of course, these things are all important, but we should not forget that there are a lot of innovations that are less dramatic, but no less important. Because when companies are engaged in production, they are making continuous improvements to the production process. They make continuous improvement to the quality of the product. So we shouldn't ignore those innovations. Because a lot of countries have this attitude, well, you know, innovation is what the Silicon Valley does. Yeah? There's no way we can do that. Yeah? No, but I mean, that's only part of innovation. I mean, look at Germany, look at Switzerland. Yeah? Okay, I mean, the Germans made huge innovations in the organic chemistry, but that's one century ago. Yeah? Since then, I mean, what kind of earth-shattering innovation have the Germans made? Yeah? None. However, it's one of the richest and most productive economies in the world because they are very good at making those sort of ground-level innovations. Yeah? This is why you buy German cars, because you know the qualities are going to be good, yeah? Even though they may be cheating on emissions. Yeah? Another point is that people, once again, when they hear the word innovation, they only think of the Silicon Valley, you know, the Steve Jobs, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, yeah? Yes, I mean, those people are important, but once again, you have to understand that innovation is a collaborative process. Yeah? Now, the Silicon Valley would not have existed without the US government research funding for defense. Yeah? A lot of those companies came from the defense research, a lot of those technologies. Yeah? And my friend Mariana Mazzucato wrote this very interesting book called The Entrepreneur State, that in one of the chapters, she shows how literally almost every technology that went into the iPhone started their life in the US government, you know, research programs. Yeah? You need government support, you need skilled workers, yeah? You need good engineers, so you have to see it as a collaborative process. Not just think about, yeah, when are we going to get our next Bill Gates, yeah? Once again, I mean, that kind of vision of innovation has discouraged a lot of countries from, you know, creating new industries, yeah, raising productivity, because they think, oh, well, we are not the United States, you know. We don't have a university like Stanford and MIT. Let's forget it. No, it's not like that, yeah? But going to your the question more directly, yeah, I think there are some obvious, yeah, technologies where, yeah, there'll be kind of revolutionary changes. We don't know when it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, but, you know, alternative energy, including, yeah, nuclear fusion and the solar energy and, yeah, things like that. I mean, that's one obvious area. Yeah? And there'll be, I mean, increasing need to improve productivity in agriculture. Yeah? The world population is growing. Water's getting scarce. Yeah? How are you going to deal with this? Yeah? And in this, the experience of the Netherlands is very instructive. Eh? Because it's a country with very little land. I mean, it's got the fifth highest population density in the world, I mean, excluding city-states like Hong Kong. Yeah? But did you know that this is the country with the third largest agriculture export in the world after the United States and France? Yeah? Because they've developed very high productivity agriculture, producing high-value products. Yeah? You don't have land? Okay, let's grow things in water. Yeah? So they built the greenhouses, put the 5 shelves of the waterbed, grow plants on the waterbed. Yeah? You have immediately increased the land area by 5 times. Yeah? You are feeding these plants high-quality chemicals, yeah, produced by companies like OXO through computer-controlled feeding programs, using computer equipment produced by companies like Philips. Yeah. They have achieved a very high productivity agriculture with these innovations. Yeah. So that's another area. But then after that, you know, there are not many obvious things. Yeah. The whole point of innovation is actually doing something that is not obvious. Yeah. So what can Croatia do? Yeah. It's a small country. I mean, that's not necessarily a binding constraint. You know, think of Finland. Yeah? When Finland basically propelled itself from the poorest country in Europe to the one of the richest between the, say, the 1930s and the 1970s, no, it had that 3.5 million people, you know, less than Croatia. Yeah, yeah, if you are small, yeah, I mean, you export. Yeah? I mean, everyone thinks that you are never going to make it into high-tech industries like electronics. Well, you keep working at it and you do it. Yeah? You know, Nokia started out as a logging company. Yeah? I mean, the trees was the only thing that Finland had in the past. Yeah? So it started as a logging company, but it kept diversifying and upgrading. Yeah? And finally, that in 1960, it decided to set up an electronics arm. Yeah? That electronics subsidiary lost money for 17 years. Yeah? But then eventually became one of the biggest electronics companies. Yeah? When Samsung, the Korean electronics company, set up its first semiconductor industry, its main business was textile and sugar refining. Yeah? It was not electronics. Yeah? And it lost money in semiconductors for 20 years. Yeah? But they did it. Yeah? Now, I'm not saying that you should necessarily get into electronics, but you know, what is it that for Croatia? Yeah? You have to do something that other people haven't thought about. Yeah? You have to invest, upgrade, innovate. Yeah? So, well, it's up to you. Yeah? Thank you. Yeah, TTIP, you know, Transatlantic Partnership. But you know, well, first of all, its proponents call it a trade agreement, but it's not really a trade agreement. It's not really about trade. Yeah, and of course, it will bring down trade barriers. But the trade barriers that exist between Europe and North America are relatively insignificant. Huh? Yeah, I mean, the average tariff of both the European Union and the United States is 3%. Yeah? Okay, 3% less tariff on, I don't know, the Americans importing German machines or, yeah, the French people importing American you know, the high-tech electronics equipment, great. But you know, it's not going to be a major, you know, influence. Huh? The main thing is about market access in things like services, including public services. Yeah? So that you could see a day when the European Union cannot block on American profit-making company coming into healthcare sector in the European country. Yeah? Most importantly, this is about redefining the relationship between governments and corporations, yeah? Because it the infamous North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, it includes this provision for investor-state dispute settlement, yeah? Which means that unlike before, now corporations can take governments to this international tribunal. It's not even a kind of proper law, court of law. I mean, it's like a three-person panel organized by the World Bank, yeah, to rule on whether a certain government regulation has harmed their profit. Yeah? So actually, within the NAFTA, a lot of regulations on the environment and labor in the US, in Mexico, in Canada have been overturned by companies taking the national governments to dispute settlement. Yeah, so when you sign this kind of agreement, you could see a huge increase in, I mean, it's not a matter of, I mean, kind of EU versus US. I mean, now we are talking about corporations versus the government, which implies corporations versus people, yeah? So that when that happens, you know, that you could see, I don't know, German companies that are suing Croatian governments, yeah, in this international panel, yeah? French companies suing American governments. I mean, this will fundamentally change the way we shape our public regulations. So I think, I mean, especially small countries that like Croatia need to be extremely careful about signing up to this. Yeah?
I would like to ask you some of the recommendations on industrial policy for the 21st century. Namely, Croatia didn't have it for the last 25 years, and now we have many problems in
industrial production, but not just there. And how should it be now in the 21st century for Croatia, but maybe also in general? And the second question is about free markets. Do we have free markets in which countries? And free from what? When we have so big influences of corporations, politicians, lobbyists, and things like that. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, first of all, the industrial policy, yes, I mean, unfortunately, industrial policy from the 90s became a dirty word that you don't say in front of a polite company. So a lot of countries have kind of abandoned industrial policy. But one thing you have to realize is that the powerful countries have done it throughout. Yeah? You know, the US claims that it doesn't have industrial policy, but it actually has the biggest industrial policy in the world. Yeah? Only that it's not called industrial policy, it's called defense research. Yeah, yeah, so that, if you look at the areas in which the US has international technological leadership, almost all of it was actually created initially by defense research funded by the US government. I mean, many of you must have heard of the internet, yeah, being developed by DARPA, an agency for the US the Pentagon. But computer was also initially developed by US military, yeah, funded by the US Army and the Pentagon. Yeah. Semiconductor, I mean, very few people know this, but semiconductor, the raw material of modern information economy, this was initially totally created by the funding from US Navy. Yeah? U.S. aircraft industry would not have existed in the way it has without massive indirect subsidies given through military plane, the research on military planes. Yeah? You know, the Germans will tell you they don't have industrial policy, but they have tons of industrial policy, only that it's not conducted at the federal level, so it's not very visible. Yeah? All the state government, the land government of Germany, have their own development bank, they work with the local industry associations, you know, they have throughout Germany, this institutes called the Fraunhofer institutes, which are sort of semi-public, semi-private research institutes that do kind of very pragmatic, business-oriented research in collaboration with the private sector. So actually, a lot of industrial policy have been done. You know, there is only the sort of small countries who are scared of these big guys who say, well, we shouldn't do industrial policy because the Americans don't do it, the Germans do it, don't do it. Well, I'm sorry, I mean, they've been doing it all the time. Yeah? So you have to find your own way. I mean, of course, there are constraints of the European Union. I'm not saying it's going to be easy because you don't even have your own, you have your own currency, yeah? But some, yeah, small European countries don't even have their own currency, so that you cannot even devalue to make your export more competitive. But you know, I mean, there are ways to do it, and I think for a country of the size of Croatia, I think you can learn a lot of lessons from the smaller Scandinavian countries like Denmark and Finland and Sweden. I mean, these three countries all did different things, but you know. A lot of industrial policies. Also, you could learn from the experiences of this local level industrial policy in countries like Germany and Switzerland and Austria. Yeah? So there are, still lots of examples that you can learn from, and you should do it because in the end, if you don't do these kind of things, I mean, you will keep losing your productive base. Yeah? I mean, I hear that the shipbuilding company in Pula is now 20% of what it used to be. You know, give it another 10 years, it will be 1% of what it used to be, which means gone. Yeah. Okay, are there free markets? Well, I have actually declared that in my book, 23 Things They Don't Tell You About Capitalism, that there is no such thing as a free market. Yeah? I mean, like beauty, freedom of the market is in the eyes of a beholder. Yeah, yeah, so that you bring the same person to the same country, same market, one person might say, wow, great, I mean, there's no restriction. Yeah, this is a free market. Another person might say, what do you mean? I mean, there are huge amount of restrictions. Yeah. So say that the American labor market, you know, a lot of the sort of free market oriented Europeans might say, wow, this is great. I mean, yeah, it's probably not 100% free market, but yeah, I mean, it's very easy to hire and fire people. You know, you don't have to give mandatory paid holidays. You know, minimum wages are quite low. You know, yeah, you might say this is a lot freer than the European market. You bring someone from the 18th century United States, the person will say, my God, I mean, what is this? Yeah? I mean, you cannot buy and sell slaves. You know, you cannot hire children. You know, you have to give, you have restrictions on working hours. You know, you have to give them safety protection and work. You know, this is not a free market. Yeah? So I think that in the end, I mean, that free market is, well, I mean, free or not, you know, in my view, market is only a means to an end. Yeah? Yes, I mean, that it's a very powerful and very often the most effective way of organizing our economic activity. But we should see it as a tool. Yeah? A means that we use to achieve certain ends. Yeah? Unfortunately, in the recent period, it has become our God, yeah? Our goal. Yeah? So we don't ask about the consequences. Yeah? We just say, well, yeah, the freer the market is, the better it is. Yeah? But is it? Yeah, yeah, and maybe better for some people, yeah? Better for some things, but at the same time, it may be terrible for some others. Yeah? Maybe very bad for the some other things. Yeah? I think that we need to kind of step back and try to see the market as one of the institutions that the humanity has invented in order to solve our economic problems. Yeah? I mean, there are other institutions like the firm, yeah? Cooperatives, yeah? Many other institutions that we have invented to organize our production and distribute income and so on, and, you know, I mean, that sometimes it's the best, sometimes it's the worst. Yeah? I mean, you have to see it like that. Otherwise, you know, if you begin to believe that this is some kind of ideal that you have to, yeah, approach, some kind of God you have to revere, then you have totally inverted your, yeah, the priority. Yeah?
A company does not always make the same kind of decisions as managers who begin from scratch,
yeah.
Or a mother can decide to buy the most expensive clothes for a teenager, another mother is going to say, no, I don't want you to have that, you need to learn the value. So can future economies benefit from more psychological research, or should it stay apart?
No, thank you. No, you know, I already said that my view is that what we do should be called economics as far as it's about studying how the economy works. Yeah, so the kind of examples that you have given are totally legitimate subjects of economics. Yeah, and yes, I mean to study those things, we need to bring in insights from psychology. Yeah? And one very good example is Herbert Simon, who I mentioned earlier. I mean, in one of my books, I describe him as the last Renaissance man. Yeah? Now, he started out as a political scientist and then moved into public administration. So he wrote this famous book called Administrative Behavior in 1947, which is still used as a classic textbook in many schools of public administration. He also has a few publications in physics, yeah, and then he later moved on to studying economics, invented the notion of bounded rationality and behavioral economics. But he spent his later years at being the professor of computer science and psychology in the famous Carnegie Mellon University, because he was into the research of artificial intelligence. Yeah? Yeah, so, you know, there you go. I mean, he's one of the best economists ever. I mean, he was actually a professor of psychology. Yeah? He wasn't a professor of, yeah, economics. He was a professor of psychology and computer science. Yeah? So, yes, I mean, psychology is extremely important. I mean, unfortunately, these days, you know, when people think about psychology, they basically think about ways to use it to manipulate people. Yeah? So nudge and all this stuff. I mean, okay. I mean, it's not, yeah, useless. But you know, you need a much deeper understanding of how people think and how our mind works. And once again, in that respect, I highly recommend the works of Herbert Simon to, you know, see the link between psychology and economics. Eh?
Expressed in 1990s, and the youth were expressed in the 1990s. So,
how came the situation here? Nowadays, the way of things is
expressed in financial terms. For example, as a football player, they said his value is so many millions of euros or something like this. Thank you.
Yes, I think that's to put it rather crudely, that's what you get if you let the logic of market take over the society. Huh? Karl Polanyi, the famous Hungarian economist slash historian slash sociologist, talked about the perils of market society. He said yeah, we need market economy, but if market logic takes over the society and if we become market society, then there's a terrible problem. Yeah? Because then we begin to judge everything by the logic of the market. But markets are very good at making decisions about certain things, but very bad at making decisions about other things. Yeah? So we have already mentioned the issue of household work. Yeah? We think women are useless because they sit at home and do nothing. Yeah, the man of the house probably would starve to death if his wife or mother didn't cook for him. Actually, there's a very interesting book written by the Swedish journalist Katrin Marshall. Marshall is a Portuguese name, but she used to be called the Kallios, called Who Cooked Adam Smith's Dinner? So Adam Smith has this famous passage in the Wealth of Nations in which he says, the reason why I can have my dinner is not because of the benevolence, but because of the self-interest of the baker and the brewer and the butcher. Yeah? So these guys sell me the meat, the beer, the bread, because they want to make money, not because they want to help me. Yeah? But Katrin Marshall is asking this question, okay, having bought those things, who actually cooked the dinner? Well, actually, in the case of Adam Smith, it turns out that it was for most of his life his mother, because he never got married. Yeah? And when his mother died, one of his cousins cooked for him. The guy never cooked at that. Yeah? So, if these women didn't cook for Adam Smith, he would be dead. Yeah? He wouldn't have been able to write this book. Yeah? So, however, simply because he wasn't paying his mother or his cousin the money for cooking, we think they had no contribution. Yeah? And let's talk about being in a university. Talk about university management. Yeah? These days, a lot of universities are shutting down subjects that don't make money. Yeah? So if you're a professor of, I don't know, German literature, social anthropology, forget it. You are destined for a dustbin, because you are not making money. Yeah? But is that the kind of society that we want? Where no one studies the literature, no one writes poem, no one does research on some obscure community in the, mountains of Nepal, No, we don't want that kind of society, so we shouldn't let these things dictate everything. Also think about the essential goods like water and postal service, and these are things that should be available to everyone. Unless social agreement, if you let this go to market, I can tell you a very interesting example. In the 1990s, Bolivia, this Latin American country, one of its cities called Cochabamba, sold the water company to Bechtel, the American company. Bechtel not only raised the water price by 4 or 5 times overnight, when some poor people who couldn't pay the water rate started collecting money, they tried to make the government prevent that these poor people from collecting rainwater. Yeah? You know, you don't want that kind of society. Yeah? So I think that basically, once again, I mean, that goes back to my earlier point that the market should be seen as a means rather than an end. You know, you want certain things to be actually divorced from the logic of the market. Yeah? Because once you link it to the market, you will destroy those things. Yeah, you will make a very barbaric society. Yeah? And of course, that decision cannot be made through economics, although economic aspect should be a part of the debate, but it should be based on a broader debate on, you know, what are the goals of your society, what do you value, you know, and how do you even define humanity, yeah? And that requires public debate, democratic debate, conversation. And I think that you know, the currently popular view that basically you should leave everything to the market and whatever doesn't make money in the market should be abolished, I think is very, very dangerous. Yeah.
So don't forget this book, donate it to the library.